Hello everyone, my name is Abhishek and welcome back to my channel. So today we are at day 40 of our complete DevOps course, and in this class we'll be learning about custom resources in Kubernetes. Okay, so before we go to the topic, I just want to make an announcement that if you haven't subscribed to my channel, definitely subscribe to my channel, because I am going to announce my future roadmap in next couple of days, where you know I'll explain you what am I going to do after this complete DevOps course. Are there going to be master classes? Are there going to be any more free courses that I'm going to conduct? So, you know, if you want to get early access to that, or if you want to follow the content right from day one, then, you know, definitely subscribe to my channel to get those interesting updates. Okay, so without wasting any time, if we jump onto the topic for today, what we will learn today is the topic related to custom resource definitions and custom resources. Okay, so on a high level, we will understand what is a custom resource definition. The shorthand for the custom resource definition is CRD, which is very popular. Like, you know, people usually say CRD, not custom resource definitions, just to be like, you know, whenever they are writing or whenever they are talking about it, so that it's very simple to say. Okay, and then we will talk about custom resources, and then we will try to understand what is a custom controller. Okay, so these are the three things that we will understand today. Now, so before I explain the topic, I will just give you a high level overview so that you understand what are we going to talk today. So this is your Kubernetes cluster. Okay, so within your Kubernetes cluster, by default, there are some, you know, resources that come out of the box. For example, you have a deployment, like you can create a deployment resource. And, you know, once you write a deployment.yaml file, a deployment is created for you, an application is created for you, which is taken care by the controller in the Kubernetes. Or you have service in Kubernetes, or you have pod in Kubernetes, or you have config map, you have secrets. So these are all the native Kubernetes resources. So they, all of them come out of the box in Kubernetes, right? But apart from this out of the box resources, so what Kubernetes says is, if you want to extend the API of Kubernetes, or you know, you want to introduce a new resource to Kubernetes. Okay, so this is very important. Okay, so if you want to introduce a new resource to Kubernetes, why you want to introduce a new resource? Because if you feel that the functionality that you need inside the Kubernetes is not supported by any of these resources. For example, let me give you a basic example. Let's say you feel that Kubernetes does not support advanced security capabilities. Okay, so for example, you have resources like KubeHunter or Kiverno or KubeProxy, sorry, or KubeBench. So all of these things try to address the security related problem. So, you know, they say that, okay, we want to introduce a new resource into Kubernetes. Or, you know, you have applications like Argo CD. What they say is, we want to introduce the GitOps capabilities to Kubernetes. Or you have applications like Flux, you have Spinnaker. So you have hundreds of applications. Like if you go to CNCF, CNCF is all about the Kubernetes controllers, like the custom Kubernetes controllers. Okay, so you have so many resources. Like whenever you want to introduce a new resource to Kubernetes, or you want to extend the API of Kubernetes to introduce a new resource, so that's when you use all of these things. Okay, so this is the high level overview. And what happens is, there are two actors here, right? The actor number one is DevOps engineer, and the actor number two is the user. So deploying the custom resource definition and the custom controller is the responsibility of the DevOps engineer. And deploying the custom resource can be the action of the user or can be the action of the DevOps engineer as well. Okay, so these are the three things that we are going to talk today, and we will try to understand with the actors. Okay, and we will try to understand the concept. Okay, so why you want to extend the API of Kubernetes, I just explained you, because whenever you want to introduce a new resource to Kubernetes, okay, probably Argo CD or Flux or Keycloak, or you know, any resource in Kubernetes, if you go to CNCF, you will find so many resources. In such cases, you need a custom resource, custom resource definition, and a custom controller. Let's try to understand each one of them, and let's try to deep dive into this concept. Okay, so firstly, like again, let's say this is your Kubernetes cluster. Okay, and what you have done is, you, like, you know, you learned about the basic concept of Kubernetes, you understood, or your organization has implemented Kubernetes, they have deployed the application as a Kubernetes deployment, and then they have created a service for it. And then they have also created an ingress resource for it. And this deployment might have used some config maps, secrets, So everything is fine. And the user who is there, he was also able to, or he or she was able to access the application through the ingress, like you have created the ingress. So, you know, let's say there is an ingress controller and your application is working fine. Like, you know, the traffic is flowing in and outside the Kubernetes cluster and your application is being used. So there is no problem at all. But after a while, what the DevOps engineering team, or you know, what you have as a DevOps engineer has said is, let me explore Kubernetes more. And as you explore Kubernetes more, you have realized that there is world beyond this native Kubernetes resources. Like, you know, you have realized that there is something called Istio, which adds, you know, service mesh capabilities to your Kubernetes cluster. Or, you know, you have realized there is an application called Argo CD, which adds the capabilities of GitOps to your Kubernetes cluster. Okay. Or you have realized that there is an application called KeyClock. What it does is it will provide a very tight identity and access management, or, you know, OAuth or OIDC capabilities to your Kubernetes cluster. So similarly, there are multiple applications that you have realized are used to enhance the behavior of your Kubernetes cluster. Your application is working fine. But once you started exploring Kubernetes, you realize that there are multiple things, like, you know, you have security related things. Okay. You have Kiverno, you have Kubebench, you have Kubeproxy. So you have realized that, you know, there is world beyond the existing Kubernetes resources. Now, how does Kubernetes support these resources? Because the number of these resources is kept growing, right? So there is not one resource like Istio or Argo CD or KeyClock. So there are multiple people in the market. There are multiple companies who says that, you know, we will provide advanced capabilities to Kubernetes clusters, or, you know, apart from the basic Kubernetes resources, use our resource to get X feature, use our resource to get Y feature on Kubernetes, use our resource to get Z feature on Kubernetes. It can be load balancing, it can be security, firewall, API gateway. So each and every company is coming to, you know, Kubernetes space, and they are saying that, okay, we will add new capabilities to Kubernetes. So how does Kubernetes handle with this? Like, you know, Kubernetes cannot go to each of these applications, and Kubernetes cannot add the logic for these applications into the Kubernetes control plane component, right? Kubernetes has accommodated logic for deployment. Kubernetes has accommodated logic for service. Kubernetes has accommodated logic for, you know, let's say config maps or secrets. But if Kubernetes has to accommodate logic for all of these things, it is practically impossible for Kubernetes team or creators of Kubernetes, because the number of these applications has reached thousands, 10,000s. You know, there are multiple custom Kubernetes controllers in the market, which are solving some or the other problem with Kubernetes. So that's why what Kubernetes said is, okay, these are the set defined resources, like, you know, whatever you are seeing here or beyond this. So we have only few resources that we support out of the box. If you want to add additional capabilities to Kubernetes, what we will do is we will allow the users to extend the API of Kubernetes. Okay, watch this or understand this point carefully. So what Kubernetes is saying, we will allow you to extend the capabilities of Kubernetes or extend the API of Kubernetes. So they are saying that you can add a new API to your Kubernetes, or you can add a new API resource to Kubernetes. Using this resource, you can ask your customers, or you can ask your whoever wants to use Istio. So what Kubernetes is saying, Istio people, is that you can create, you can extend the Kubernetes, like probably whoever your users are, you can ask them to deploy a few resources, and you know, you can this way you can extend the Kubernetes clusters, but we are not going to support it. So to extend the API or to extend the capabilities of API, there are three resources in Kubernetes. Okay, now I think you understood the problem. So the three resources are CRD, like I told you in the first slide, then you have CR, then you have custom controller. Let us try to dive into each of them and let us try to understand. First one, CRD. Okay. So CRD is nothing but custom resource definition. That means you are defining whoever it is. Like, when I say you, it's not you, but for example, if there is a company called Istio, and Istio says that we want to enhance the capability of Kubernetes. So Kubernetes people are saying Istio to create a CRD. What is a CRD? Defining a new type of API to Kubernetes. Okay, so define a new type of Kubernetes API to Kubernetes. And how do you define is you have to submit a custom resource definition to Kubernetes. Okay, so people of Istio will create a new custom resource definition. And in this custom resource definition, like it's a YAML file. And in this YAML file, you will define things like, you know, what a user can create. For example, if you are a user or if you are a user who are creating a deployment.yaml file. Okay, so in your deployment.yaml file, probably you have mentioned few things, like you have said, what is the API? What is the kind? What is the spec? Inside spec, what is the template? What is the pod? What is the container? What is the container port? But beyond this, how does Kubernetes understand whatever the deployment.yaml you have created is correct or not? So Kubernetes will have a template which has all the fields related to deployment.yaml. Like, you know, tomorrow you can add volume mounts. Tomorrow you can add mounts. Or tomorrow you have added a new field called XYZ. So Kubernetes will say that immediately when you create a new field called XYZ in the deployment.yaml, you will get an error. Okay. What error you will get? Field XYZ is not known. If you have a question, like go to your deployment.yaml file and, you know, write a new field in the inside the spec, try to create a new field called XYZ. So Kubernetes will immediately throw an error called field XYZ is not known, or some error Kubernetes will throw at you. Okay. So how Kubernetes is throwing this error? Because Kubernetes knows what is the definition of a deployment. Okay. Out of this definition, you can use whatever is required or you can omit whatever is not required. But this is the standard definition that Kubernetes has. Similarly, even for the custom resource, or what is a custom resource? Custom resource is a custom, like, you know, it's a new, or it's a, you know, a variable resource that you are submitting to Kubernetes. But before anyone submits, Kubernetes asks you to extend or define a new type of API to Kubernetes using the custom resource definition, where people of Istio, if you are taking Istio as an example, they will provide a complete YAML file, which will have all the possible options that they support. Okay, a CRD is a YAML file, which is used to introduce a new type of API to Kubernetes, and that will have all the fields a user can submit in the custom resource. Okay. Like, for example, if you take about a resource called deployment.yaml, and for the deployment.yaml, you have a resource definition inside your Kubernetes. So this is a general resource of Kubernetes, and this is a general resource definition of Kubernetes. But because we are dealing with custom resources, that's why we call this as a custom resource definition. Okay, and whatever the user is submitting, we call it as a custom resource. Okay, let's try to understand this in detail. Okay, so we'll try to compare it with deployment.yaml itself so that you people will understand. For example, you are a user, you are creating a deployment.yaml. Okay, so this is a YAML file that you are submitting. Let's say this is a deployment.yaml file. Okay, inside the deployment.yaml file, what you will do is you will say my API version, okay, apps v1, and then you will say my kind, then you will say metadata, then you will say spec. Inside the spec, you will say template, you will say container, all of these things. Okay, but how does Kubernetes understand if your YAML definition is correct or not? So like I told you, this is a Kubernetes resource that you are creating. Similarly, Kubernetes has a resource definition in the API, okay, in the API server, or in the Kubernetes controller manager. Okay, so what does this resource definition do? It will validate if the resource that you have created is right or wrong. Okay, so the resource definition in the Kubernetes will try to understand if the user created resource is correct or not. Similarly, even in case of custom resource definition, okay, so custom resource definition is a custom resource that you are adding to Kubernetes to enhance the behavior of Kubernetes or to extend the API of Kubernetes. So even in that, what a user will do is, as a user, he will create a custom resource. Okay, so because we are talking about Istio, let us take about the Istio example itself. So Istio has a custom resource called virtual service. Okay, so what here user will do? He will say API version is something related to Istio. Then he will say kind as virtual service. Then he will say spec, I mean metadata obviously. And then he will say spec. He will say few properties. Okay. I mean, nobody will remember this. You will go to Istio documentation and you will see what is the resource YAML file that is required for the is the virtual service. You will have a bunch of examples there. Okay. So this is a, what is this virtual service? This virtual service is a custom resource. Now, who will validate this custom resource? So this custom resource, like I told you, is validated against a custom resource definition, that is CRD, that you have submitted or the Istio people have created. You can, as a DevOps engineer, you can deploy this custom resource onto your Kubernetes cluster so that your Kubernetes cluster is extended. Okay. So the two functionalities, one is for the CRD is to extend the capabilities of API, Kubernetes API, and also to validate. So right now you have understood the difference, right? If I try to compare this with a native Kubernetes resource against a custom resource of Kubernetes, the process is same. Here you are creating a deployment.yaml file. On the contrary, here the user will create a virtual service YAML file. Okay. And this is validated against the resource definition. Here this will be validated against the custom resource definition. Now, like once you think this is done, okay, but this is not done yet. So you have created a, or user has created a custom resource. Okay. So user has submitted a CR, validated against a CRD. Let's say this, both of the things are fine. You have created a CRD. It is, you have created a CR. It is validated against the CRD, and CR is created inside your Kubernetes cluster. Let's say it is created inside your K8s cluster. Now, if you think this is done, this is not done yet. Okay. If you think this is over, this is not over, because you have created a custom resource. But like I told you, if you take the same example of deployment, you might have created a deployment.yaml onto your Kubernetes cluster, which is validated against the deployment resource definition. After that, you will know that inside Kubernetes, there is something called as a deployment controller. Right? So this deployment controller is the one that is, you know, it is taking care of creating a replica set. Right? And replica set controller will create a pod. So there is a process that is happening. And who is doing this? A Kubernetes controller is doing it. So similarly, here there has to be a custom controller, or you can call it as a custom Kubernetes controller. Okay. So this is the flow. So actually arrow should point here. Okay. So there has to be a custom Kubernetes controller that is already deployed inside your Kubernetes cluster, so that once you deploy your custom resource, let's say you have deployed your CR, this controller will watch for the CR and it will do some action. Okay. So now let us take this into a diagram and understand. Okay. So if this is a Kubernetes cluster, first of all, DevOps engineer, that is the people who are watching this video, maybe, or people might be developers or someone else as well, but most of our audience who are DevOps engineer, what they will do, step one, okay, if the organization decides to use Istio, for example, or if the organization use any other example, step one is they will deploy the CRD onto the Kubernetes cluster. How they will deploy this? They will go to the Istio documentation. They'll find what is the CRD, and they will deploy either using the plain Kubernetes manifests, or they can deploy it using the Helm charts, or they can deploy them using the operator. Anything is possible. Okay. So using the CRD, they go to the docs and they deploy the CRD. Who deploys the CRD? So the DevOps engineers have deployed a new CRD. Let's call it as a, because we are talking about Istio, let's call it as a virtual service CRD. Okay. So virtual service CRD is deployed onto your Kubernetes cluster now. Now, there is another actor here, and this actor is nothing but a user. So you can consider it as a developer or a DevOps engineer or anyone. Okay. Now what this user will do, again, he will also go to Istio docs, and because he wants to use the capabilities of Istio inside the cluster, he will create a custom resource. What is this custom resource? Let's say he has a namespace called Abhishek. So inside this Abhishek namespace, he will create a Istio virtual service custom resource. Let's call it as VS. So he has created a VS custom resource. Now, Like I told you, before it getting created, the API server or you know someone will intercept this request and they will try to validate it against the virtual service CRD. And if the request is correct, then the request will pass through. If not, the request will fail, right? So this is the process that will happen. Let's say you have created, the user has created a proper custom resource, he went to the documentation and he has created a proper custom resource, which is validated and deployed inside your Kubernetes cluster. But till here, you have just deployed a custom resource, it will just stay there. Like for example, if you just deploy a ingress resource without ingress controller, what will happen? Nothing will happen, right? Like we discussed in the previous class, the ingress resource will be of no use. Similarly, you have just deployed a custom resource. If you deploy a deployment, there is a deployment controller which is taking or which is doing something for you. But here, this custom resource is being watched by no one till now, right? So if nobody is watching it, then nothing is going to happen, right? So someone has to watch this custom resource. So again, the action two here of the DevOps engineer would be to deploy a custom controller. So again, how this custom controller is deployed? Again, he will go to the documentation. He will either deploy them using the Helm chart, plain manifest or operator, whatever the DevOps engineer wants to follow the process within the organization. So now again, he can create this across the cluster, the custom controller, or he can just create for the specific namespace depending upon the feature that controller supports. Let's say, because we are dealing with Abhishek namespace, so DevOps engineer will deploy a custom controller here. So now this custom resource is verified by the controller and controller will perform the required action. In this case, what is the required action? The required action is Istio, that is service mesh or mutual TLS or, you know, east-west traffic, whatever it is. Let's not go into the details of it. Horizontal traffic or east-west traffic, mutual TLS, whatever the configuration that you want to do. So this Istio controller, which you deployed, will read the custom resource and it will perform the action. So whenever you are getting confused with respect to custom resources or custom resource definition, the simplest thing that you will do is try to understand it with the native resource itself. Because whether it is a native resource like deployment or the custom resource, the only difference would be in case of custom resource, you will deploy all the required resources. Whereas in case of deployment, there are these resources out of the box available on the cluster. Okay. But the steps are common. First step is, for any custom resource or for any, applications like Istio or Argo CD, the steps are common. That is, first step would be you have to deploy the custom resource definition to extend the capabilities of your Kubernetes cluster. Second step would be, you have to deploy the custom controller. And the third step is the user who wants to use this feature on their Kubernetes cluster. Like you might have 100 namespaces, but only 20 namespaces might want to use this feature. Okay, so whoever the users or whoever the namespaces that they want to use, what they will do is they will deploy the custom resource. So similarly, if you compare with deployment, so by default inside Kubernetes cluster, you have a resource definition for deployment. As a user, you are creating a deployment in Kubernetes, which is validated against the resource definition of your Kubernetes. And instead of the custom controller for deployment inside your Kubernetes, you have a native Kubernetes controller. Okay, so this is the concept of custom resource definition and a custom controller. Now some interesting points, just for your understanding, how one can write a custom controller. So the very popular way of writing a custom controller is using Golang. You can write using Python, you can write using Java as well, but the community or the very popular medium of writing a custom Kubernetes controller using Golang. One of the primary reasons is, you know, Kubernetes application itself is written in Golang. Okay. So one of the popular Kubernetes, APIs is client Go. Now you have client Python, you have client Java, everything. But, you know, initially when Kubernetes was developed, to extend the capabilities of Kubernetes, Kubernetes has something as a client Go, which will allow, you to interact with the Kubernetes API. So whenever I'm saying you want to extend the capabilities of Kubernetes, that means to say the users has to interact with the Kubernetes API, right? Just like kubectl interacts with the Kubernetes API. Whenever you want to write a custom controller, you have to, or you might want to talk to your Kubernetes. For that, inside the Kubernetes API server, there is a component called client Go. Okay, so this client Go will allow you to talk to the Kubernetes API server. So initially it was only client Go. But later point of time, there is now you can write it in Python, you can write it in Java because Kubernetes has API supported for different things. That is fine. But you know, because the community has started with Go and Kubernetes itself is written in Go and the entire CNCF ecosystem, you know, because of the features of Golang, like, you know, multi, like the concurrency or, you know, the easy way of writing it, all of the things we will try to learn whenever we are trying to learning the Golang. But for now, because, you know, initially the community has started in Go language and the client Go support is very well. There is a very good community for the client Go and the CNCF ecosystem with Go language. All of these controller, custom controllers are written in Golang. So even when you want to write a new custom controller, the preferred way would be to use Golang. Okay. And how do you write a custom controller? On a very high level, okay, I'm not going into the details because if you want to learn this, probably I can take a new class because many of our subscribers might not understand Golang or, you know, many of our subscribers are beginners to DevOps or they're just learning Kubernetes. So I don't want to go into the depth. But you can put that in the comment section if you want to understand this in detail. Now, so what you will do is you will use Golang as your programming language. And like I told you, if this is your Kubernetes cluster or this is your API server, so there is a component called client Go. You will interact with the client Go and the entire process depends on setting the watchers, listers and watchers. Okay. So what you will do is by default, this client Go or by default, your Kubernetes will be watching for a set of watchers. Like, you know, there is a deployment watcher, there is a service watcher. So whenever you are creating or whenever you are performing any of these actions like update, delete or create. Okay. So what happens is there is inbuilt watchers that Kubernetes has created for this resources. So whenever one of these actions is performed, Kubernetes will come to know using these watchers. But if you want to write a custom Kubernetes controller, then you have to create your new watchers. So early when I started writing Kubernetes controllers back in 2015, there, you know, the frameworks were not strong or there were no lot of frameworks. So you have to create your own watchers, everything right from scratch. But right now you have many frameworks, like one of the very popular ones is you can use the Kubernetes controller runtime. So, you know, this is a Go one that is supported by Kubernetes itself. It's a Golang based Kubernetes package. So using this also, you can set up your watchers. Like, let's say what people might, people at Istio might have done is they have set up watchers for virtual service. So any action, like I told you, users will create a virtual service, right? Whenever they are creating or deleting or updating. So there is watchers that is configured for this virtual service. And this watchers, you know, they will notify client Go. So again, in client Go, there is a package called reflector. So I'm not, like I'm telling you, I don't want to go into the details of it. So using this reflector, then, you know, what you will do is whenever you find to understand, whenever you understand that a new virtual service is created, you can put that in a FIFO queue. So you will put that in a worker queue and you know, you will start reading each of the elements or each of the objects in the worker queue and like watchers will identify and you will put that in the worker queue and then you will start processing each and every resource. Okay. So this way, like once your controller starts processing each and every object in the queue, then it starts creating the required functionality on the Kubernetes. In this case, it will start creating a virtual service configuration on your Kubernetes cluster. So this is a very high level concept. If you want to write a custom controller, like if you are interested more, you can go for a sample Kubernetes custom controller. I'll put the link in the description. A very good documentation, which will help you to understand how to write a sample Kubernetes custom controller. Kubernetes supports some documentation as well. And go for the controller runtime as your medium of writing. If you want to write operators, then you can use operator SDK as well. What is operator? How is it different from controller? Not the topic. Today we are not dealing with this topic. Okay. So now let me not go into the details of it. So this is some interesting things that I wanted to explain. And if you want to write a CRD, okay. So DevOps engineers will not write custom controllers or CRDs, most of the DevOps engineers, but if you are in a Kubernetes developer role, and if you want to write your, in your organization, if you are required to write a new Kubernetes custom controller, then you might have to know all of these things. Like in my role, I have to write Kubernetes controllers. I have deal day in, day out with Kubernetes controllers. So I know all of these things. But even if you want to write a custom resource definition, that's not difficult. You can write a resource definition very easily. Okay, now let me show you one example just for your understanding. How does a custom Kubernetes controller would look like and what are the parameters, how to deploy them and all of those things. So quickly, I'll stop sharing here. Stop share and let me start sharing my other screen. So I hope till now the topic is very clear to you. And I will just take one example because we have been discussing about Istio. Let us take example of Istio itself to just show you, okay, how does this custom controllers and how they operate, okay? Perfect, just go to GitHub or yeah, first let's go to GitHub. And so this is your GitHub page. You can just search for Istio, Istio, okay? So if you just search for Istio, Istio, so this is the Istio repository. So if you want to know the list of popular custom controllers in Kubernetes, the best way is to go to CNCF. Okay, so CNCF is Cloud Native Computing Foundation. And inside this, you have a lot of Kubernetes, like for example, I work on Argo CD. So these are all the, like they have 20 graduated projects, 37 incubating projects and 93. So all of these are custom Kubernetes controllers like Argo CD, Istio, Backstage, Build Packs. Okay, so all of these or the custom Kubernetes controllers, which are very popular in the community, not just these things. So these are from the CNCF. CNCF is a, like you can consider it as a Linux Foundations project or CNCF is a community. Basically that is backing up or giving support to all of these projects. Like if you get your project incubated with CNCF, then you get a lot more attention or, you know, you get a lot of more support for your projects. Okay. So Creo is one, Core DNS is one. Crossplane, which we discussed in one of the classes, is one. So these are all the custom Kubernetes controllers which are very popular in the community. Prometheus, I think most of you know about Prometheus, right? So you can go to any of their projects. Like in my case, because I've been talking about Istio the whole video, so this is Istio. Okay, so if you are a DevOps engineer and if your organization has decided to use Istio, what you will do is if you want to read through the code, so this is the Istio Go language code. It is open source. You can start reading it. But on a, like, you know, if firstly, if you start with it, you'll find it slightly difficult. So if you are a beginner and if you want to understand the code, firstly, go to the package folder. So inside the package folder, like, you know, anyways, like this will be very difficult to understand from here. So use the example that I put in the description. That is Kubernetes sample custom controller, like Kubernetes sample controller. Okay, so I'll put the link in the description as well, but this is the GitHub page where Kubernetes people will explain you how to write a sample Kubernetes controller. Okay, like I told you, you use a lot of packages, like there is a code generator, okay, and then there is a controller manager, sorry, controller runtime. So you can use make use of all of these things. Just follow the documentation. They'll explain you how to write the Go code for the controller as well, and how to write a custom resource definition. There are a bunch of examples on how to write a custom resource. So just follow this specific GitHub repository if you are interested. Like I'm telling you, for most of the DevOps job roles, this might not be important. You only need to understand the concept, how to deploy a custom resource, how to deploy a controller, how they are working in the backend. Whatever I explained in the theory part, this should be more than enough for you. But if you are in a challenging DevOps role where you take care of writing Kubernetes controllers as well, okay, where you are contributing, like probably you are an open source contributor for any of these projects, like I'm doing. So in such cases, you might require this kind of knowledge. If not, you can stop at the video where I explained you all of these things and you can see how to deploy these custom resources. Okay, so this is about Istio, right? Like I'm telling you, you can go through the code in this GitHub repository. After that, you know, what you need to do is go to the introduction. Inside anything, you can just go to their official documentation of Istio. Where is it? In this case, the official documentation. Yeah, so this is the istio.io. This is the official documentation. And here you will find the installation page. Okay, so this is taking some time, but basically you will have a Helm chat. I'll show you. The Helm chat will take care of the deployment of the custom resource definition as well as your custom controller. Okay, so both of the things will be deployed. So let's go to the documentation and inside the documentation, setup, right? So if you are a DevOps engineer, you have to do these things. Okay, so get installation guides, go here. And now you need to understand, okay, take any of these things, install with Helm. because Helm is a quite popular one. Okay, so all that you need to do is you just need to copy these commands, okay, called helm repo add istio, and then update the helm repo for the istio, and then you know you will see that the istio related custom controllers will be created in your namespace along with the CRDs. So after that, it's up to the users to just go and deploy the istio virtual service. For example, okay, if I just want to show you quickly, just copy this one here, and if you have a Kubernetes cluster handy, what you can do is, I don't know if it today looks like my network is slow, but I'll try to show you. Okay, so I am just creating the Helm things for this. So it says update complete, happy Helming, perfect, thank you. And after this, the installation steps is to choose any of the Helm release and all of these things. Okay, so now I have to choose the Helm release as well. I thought they have a, no problem. Yeah, I think this is fine here. Firstly, create a namespace for Istio. Okay, so I'm creating a namespace for Istio. Just follow the documentation. As a DevOps engineer, you can go through the documentation of how to create the steps for installing the custom resource definition and the custom Kubernetes controller. But once you do this, you have to understand the concept. Like I told you, how does Istio work? How, what is a custom, like, you know, what is a virtual service in Istio? All of these things you have to know by yourself. Okay. So your role is to just deploy this custom resources, custom resource definition, custom controller. And apart from that, if your teammates has any problem with Istio, then you have to solve it. Not the Golang related code or not the controller or anything, but if they say that, you know, my Istio virtual service is not working, then you have to go to the Istio controller, look for the logs, what is happening there, if the virtual service resource is properly created or not, what is the status of the virtual service, describe the virtual service resource. So this kind of debugging is expected from you as a DevOps engineer. Okay, so now if I just do Helm Istio, you will notice that the CRD installation is created. Okay, see, so you have a new resource, or you can just say kubectl get CRD. So you will see that the Istio related, so these are all the Istio related custom resources. So in case of Istio, there are a lot of custom resources. Don't worry about it. But you know, this is how you create a custom resource. After that, again, follow the documentation and create your Istio related. Okay. So by using this command, now your Istio related controller will be created. So there is no rocket science here. All that you need to do is just follow the documentation and create every configuration like custom resources definition and your Kubernetes custom controller. So this is for Helm Istio, but the same process will be for Argo CD, same process will be for Prometheus, anything. You just install their Helm charts, which will deploy their custom resources definition and also their custom controller, which is a deployment. Okay, so this is the configuration related to it. If you have any questions, just post that in the comment section. But as a DevOps engineer, like I'm telling you, one of your primary responsibilities is this. And after that, to debug. Like if your organization is using Istio, you have to read through the Istio documentation completely and you have to understand about Istio. Okay, just deployment is not your part. You have to understand each and everything here. How Istio service mesh is working, what are the configurations that are required, if user is getting any questions with respect to Istio destination rules, what is the envoy proxy in Istio, right? All of these things you have to know as DevOps engineers, apart from the installation and configuration. Okay, so this might take some time, but there is again no point of just creating the deployment. I wanted you to explain the concept. So I hope you like the video for today. If you have any questions, put that in the comment section and don't forget to subscribe my channel. Thank you so much for watching the video today. I'll see you in the next video. Take care, everyone. Bye.